Another victory today for critics of the controversial indefinite detention law. A federal judge has ruled that the government cannot use that law to hold people in military prisons indefinitely. The ruling comes after a group of journalists and activists sued the government over the provision. They say it's unconstitutional and fear they could be indefinitely detained under the law because their jobs sometimes require them to interact with terrorists. Well, the government interpreted an injunction put in place by a judge a couple of weeks ago to apply only to a handful of plaintiffs in the lawsuit. But now the judge is saying no, this is to be applied broadly to all Americans. To discuss what this all means for your rights, one of those plaintiffs joins me now in this case. He's not a plaintiff. He's actually been following the case, though. David Siegel, executive director of Demand Progress, joins me now live from Rhode Island. Hi, David.
Hi, thanks very much for having me.
So I just want to get your reaction to the judge's ruling.
We're thrilled by it, just as we were thrilled by her first ruling a few weeks ago. So in mid-May, Judge Forrest determined that indefinite detention is unconstitutional. The Obama administration moved for reconsideration of that ruling, and to the extent to which she reconsidered anything, she decided even more strongly in favor of the plaintiffs and made it clear that her initial ruling applies not just to the seven plaintiffs in question, but applies broadly to civilians across America.
And I believe we do have a quote from that ruling. Let's bring it up there. It states, quote, the Supreme Court has made it clear that when a plaintiff claims that a law is facially vague and violates his or her constitutional right to due process, that party seeks to vindicate not only his or her own right, but those of others who may also be adversely impacted by the statute in question. So, David, I want to talk a little bit more about the implications of that. The plaintiffs, I would assume that they didn't want this to just apply to just them, that they wanted to bring it to question the constitutionality of this in regards to all American citizens.
Right, exactly. And their argument, there are several, but the thrust of it is that the law is so vague and captures potentially, essentially anybody who's seen to be an associate of any anti-state actor, anybody who's accused of being a terrorist. And this could affect a whole swath of people, including activists and journalists who will travel abroad and interview people who might explicitly be members of the Taliban or Hamas or other groups that our government has deemed to be terrorist organizations. And that they, by that association, could be deemed worthy of indefinite detention.
Let's talk a little bit more about the greater implications of the NDAA and why Americans should be concerned about the controversial provisions in the law. What danger does it pose?
It has our government abdicating its obligation to engage in essential due process. It means that civilians can be detained indefinitely by the military without ever being charged with I'm sorry, there was a screw up on my end. Are you still there?
Still here. Go on. You were talking about the controversial provisions of the law.
That Americans can be detained indefinitely, civilians, by the military without being charged with any crime, without being tried, without having access to their essential due process rights that were one of the foundations upon which our country was founded and upon which the Constitution was written. And we're slowly seeing all sorts of civil liberties slip away, as your viewers are undoubtedly aware, in the name of defending us against terrorists. And this is one of the more egregious examples of that that we've seen to date.
And David, I do want to bring attention to something that happened just yesterday in Colorado. Police reportedly responded to a bank robbery by arresting dozens of people. Reports suggest that cops trapped as many as 40 cars and handcuffed at least 19 people, most of them presumably innocent. This was at gunpoint. Take a look at some of the coverage on what happened yesterday.
Police pin in this group of cars. Drivers are ordered to get their hands up.
And they got behind shields. They had the M4s, shotguns out, the taser guns, everything.
We didn't know what the heck was going on. We didn't know if we were in the line of fire.
One by one, drivers are pulled out at gunpoint and handcuffed. They're told nothing as their cars are searched.
So some of those detained say they were held without charges for hours. I mean, this is different from the NDAA. You know, it's not a military prison. But is this an example of what can happen under the NDAA and the dangers posed in that law?
I've only seen a bit of coverage about that specific incident. Obviously, it strikes me as egregious from what I've seen. And it's the sort of thing that we're concerned about, just an increasing police steadiness that's taking hold in this country, and a militarization of that police state. I think it was Chris Hedges I was speaking to recently put it really well. And there's not much of a difference now in the form of a raid in Fallujah as opposed to a raid on a house sheltering Occupy Wall Street protesters in Oakland or Miami. Dark of the night, machine guns, flak jackets, and we're seeing an arms race within police departments across the land and decreased concern about rights to due process.
All right, so we are seeing this is a victory for critics of the NDAA. What's next in this fight and making sure that this controversial law is not implemented?
So we at Demand Progress are asking people to act along two fronts. The first is to urge Obama to cease his crusade against civil liberties and not appeal this ruling to a higher court, which he'll have to decide whether or not to do in the coming weeks. And so he might seek a higher court ruling reversing Judge Forrest's decision, and we're putting pressure on him to not do so. And we're also asking the Senate, as it takes up this year's NDAA, to support amendments to reverse the indefinite detention provisions. And we expect that will hit the floor of the Senate sometime later this month. There was an effort in the House to do the same that failed by a relatively narrow margin. The coalition of libertarian-leaning Republicans and progressives who came together to fight indefinite detention, and it lost by on the order of 30 or 40 votes. We hope that we have a better chance in the Senate, because amendments to do just that, to reverse indefinite detention, came relatively close to passing when the NDAA was taken up in December.
All right, David, thank you very much for coming on the show. That was David Siegel, Executive Director of Demand Progress.
Thanks very much for having me.